morning, y'all. My name is Dave. Good to be back with you today. And for the coming season, it'd be an honor to be journeying with you. The Mediterranean port of Aqaba in 1917 seemed impregnable. Any enemy vessel approaching from the sea would have to face this huge battery of naval guns that were positioned above the town, and behind the town, in every direction, lay barren, waterless, inhospitable desert. The deadly anvil of the sun. How would you like to try to cross the anvil of the sun? Not the most hospitable sounding place. The Ottoman Turks ruled Aqaba, and they believed this town to be safe from any attack. They were wrong. T.E. Lawrence, that is Lawrence of Arabia, led a force of irregular Arab cavalry across the anvil of the sun on horseback, camelback. They rallied support among the local people, and on July 6, 1917, the Arab forces swept into Aqaba from the north, from the blind side. And if you've seen the movie Lawrence of Arabia, this is the climax of that movie, with this long panning shot of these Arabs on their horses, their camels, with Lawrence leading them, galloping past these gigantic naval guns that are completely powerless to stop them because they're pointing in the wrong direction. Aqaba fell, and the Turkish hold on Palestine was broken, later to be replaced by British rule, and eventually to become the modern state of Israel. The Turks failed to hold Aqaba for two reasons. One, they did not know their enemy. Two, they did not have the right equipment. They didn't know their enemy, didn't have the right equipment. Hold on to that. We have to be careful not to make the same mistakes in our spiritual lives. Paul the Apostle concluded his letter to the Ephesian church knowing the spiritual battles that they and we would have to face. And so, in concluding his letter, he reminds them and us who our enemy is and what equipment we're going to need to fight our enemy. If you have a Bible with you, I invite you to turn now to Ephesians 6, verse 10. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. And if you're engaging with us online, I'd like for you to do that as well. That's our text this morning. Here's what the question. How do we win at spiritual warfare? How do we win at spiritual warfare? Paul gives us three strategies, Ephesians 6:10. Finally, he says, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Okay, there's more. We're going to stop there for a minute. First thing I need to say is a bit of an aside. If you are not a follower of Jesus Christ, if you're not a Christian, today's message is going to sound kind of kooky, spooky, fairy tale-ish to you. Okay? I get that. It would to me too, right? But if you grant the existence of God an unseen spiritual force, then there's no logical reason that you shouldn't also grant the existence of the devil an unseen spiritual force who is opposed to the work of God, tries to undo the work of God, tries to thwart the work of God. Okay? Just acknowledging, it's maybe a little out there. Give it a chance. Because I'm not making this up. This is the Word of God. Okay, Paul gives us three strategies for winning at spiritual warfare. Three strategies for spiritual success. The first is this. We need to know our enemy. We need to know our enemy. Paul says, spiritual battles are fought against spiritual enemies. He says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, and by that he's just using an expression that means human. Our struggle is not with humans. Other people are not your enemy. Rather, our struggle is with evil spiritual forces, the devil, demons, dark powers. And I think we lose sight of that. Because it's very easy to see or hear someone who's human who is giving you a hard time. Someone who has sinned against you. Someone who has let you down, betrayed you, said malicious gossip, false things about you. You think, that person is my enemy. Well, Paul says there's something going on behind that that you can't see. Other people are not our real enemy. Spiritual, our enemy is spiritual. And that real enemy wants us to see other people as the enemy, or other groups of people as the enemy. He wants husbands to see their wives as their enemy, and vice versa. He wants kids to see their parents as the enemy, and vice versa. He wants bosses to see their employees as the enemy, and vice versa. He wants Republicans to see Democrats as the enemy, and vice versa. You go on down the line. Fill in the blanks. People are not our enemy. The devil is our enemy. And Paul talks about the schemes of the devil and reminds us of the trickery and the subterfuge by which evil and temptation present themselves in our lives. I have a picture of some pretty flowers to show you. Look on the left, two beautiful flowers, right? Look closer. In that circle that the arrow is pointing, that's the same picture, I just put a circle and an arrow on it. There is a yellow crab spider sitting in the middle of that second flower, awaiting whatever insect might happen to hop by and think, I'm going to do some pollinating or I'm just going to take a rest. No, it's going to become lunch for the crab spider. Certain species of crab spider, I learned this week in researching this message, have the ability to, over a period of days, adapt the color of their environment, kind of like a chameleon. And so they sit and they wait. They look harmless. You can't even see that they're there. They're invisible. They're waiting to grab you and do you harm if you're an insect. That's how our enemy works. Evil, wickedness, spiritual dark forces rarely look evil until they accomplish their goal. Evil gains entrance by appearing attractive, appearing desirable, appearing legitimate. It is a baited, camouflaged trap. The best definition of temptation I've ever heard is this. It says, the devil comes to you when you are tired and makes a perfectly reasonable suggestion that you know you should not grant. It seems harmless. Maybe not even seem like a temptation until you're caught. Know your enemy. The Battle of Antietam. I use a lot of military history in this message. I apologize for those of you who aren't into that. Battle of Antietam in 1862. The American Civil War lasted for 12 hours. It ranks as the bloodiest single day in American history. 10,000 Confederate casualties, even more on the Union side. Though tactically a draw, the mediocre Union General George McClellan was able to thwart General Robert E. Lee's thrust into Maryland and forced him to retreat back across the Potomac River. How is this possible? How did General McClellan fight General Lee to a draw? Well, because General McClellan had General Lee's battle plan. Two Union soldiers had found a copy of General Lee's battle plans in a field in which the battle plans wrapped three cigars. Somebody left them behind. Changed American history. These soldiers delivered the battle plans to General McClellan before the engagement, and somewhere the cigars went missing. But the battle plans were put in General McClellan's hands, and so he was able to anticipate what General Lee was going to do, what the Confederate armies were going to do, and parry their thrusts. In some respects, you and I are no match for our adversary, Satan. I would not want to have to go one-on-one with that being. His schemes, we are told to be wary of, but as with General McClellan, the enemy's plans have been revealed to us. They've fallen into our hands. We know his strategies to entice with lies, lust, greed, apathy, divisions, and the like. We know what to look for. And so with such knowledge given to us by God's Word, God's Spirit within us, we can resist His advances. We can resist His schemes. So, we know our enemy, but are we equipped to fight? Verse 13, Paul says, "Therefore, put on the full armor of God." He's already mentioned this once. "Put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." All right, first strategy to winning in spiritual warfare, need to know your enemy, know who your enemy is. Second strategy, Paul says, you need the right equipment. We need the right equipment. And the armor of God, be understood as the armor God provides. It could be the armor that God himself wears, or even you could translate it, the armor that is God himself. In the end, all this armor language, this illustration, is a way to talk about identifying with God and his purposes. Now, there's no good way to translate this into English, but in Greek, the commands that Paul gives are all plural. They're all plural. We usually think of it, I've heard this passage a lot, and I usually think of it, okay, you, each individual Christian, you need to go put on the armor of God. Now, you need to put on your helmet, you put on your breastplate, your belt, all that stuff. But really what he's saying is, y'all, the church, need to put on the armor of God. Okay? All y'all, Crow Hill Bible Church, need to put on the armor of God. And so that you stand collectively as God's people and stand as one person. Put on the belt of truth. What's foundational? Truth is just foundational, right? We don't believe in Christianity because it works. We believe Christianity because it's true. And it works because it's true. It's not true because it works. So the belt of truth is absolutely foundational. Then the second thing, breastplate, body armor, the Kevlar of righteousness, he says. Don't let sin worm its way in and corrupt you and destroy you. Put on the breastplate of righteousness. Shoes, the shoes of the gospel of peace. What's he talking about? That's shoes go take you places, right? He's talking about the willingness to share the gospel with others. To go where the Lord tells you, where he prompts you, to carry the gospel with you. The shield, faith, helmet of salvation, that's absolutely vital. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. It's been pointed out the sword is the only offensive part of the armor that Paul lists is God's word. You can also defend yourself with a sword, though. Maybe one reason that we don't overcome temptation is that we're going into battle unprepared, ill-equipped for what we're going to face. Because here's the thing. Once your enemy attacks, it's too late to start getting ready. Once your enemy attacks you, it's too late to start getting ready. If you're quarterbacking a football team and the defense decides to blitz and you have too many guys rushing after you with not enough people to block for you, that's the wrong time to put on your helmet. You're going to be an ugly little grease stain on the football turf. Paul did not say, men and women of God, he did not say, study and discuss the armor of God. He did not say, memorize the armor of God. He did not say, sing songs about the armor of God. He said, put it on. Right? Wear it. And wear it as one people together. There's no shortcuts to spiritual strength. Putting on the armor of God is actually routine a lot of days. Not real exciting, not real thrilling, but we can't fight our enemy. We don't win spiritual battles unless we're wearing the right equipment. So we need to wear all the armor of God. Years ago, I had a Toyota Corolla that had power locks. And I was happy with my Corolla, liked it. But one day, for no reason, my power locks started locking only three of the four doors. The rear left side door, the power lock just stopped working. I'm not mechanical, I don't know why, I don't know if it's an electrical problem or a wire fell off or something. It just stopped locking. And I realized this, and I kind of would play with the switch, and others would go up and down, but that one just wouldn't. It would lock, though, if I just manually pushed the lock down. So, okay, not really a problem. I didn't feel like taking the time or spending the money to get that fixed, as long as I knew there was a problem. But time after time after time, I would, you know, go to the shopping mall, or I'd go to the grocery store or whatever, and I would open my car door, I would hit the locks, and I would shut my door, thinking my car was locked. And if you looked, it looked locked because three of the four doors were locked. But was my car locked? No. Because anybody could have come along and said, hey, that back door's open. Happily, I never had anything in my car that was worth stealing. Even the car itself was not worth stealing. But I had to remind myself, okay, every time I take my car out someplace, I need to remember to lock that back door myself so that the whole car is locked. Likewise, people of God, we need to equip ourselves with all the armor of God. All the armor of God. Put it on. Wear it. Keep it on. Paul says, know your enemy, who your enemy is. He says, be equipped with the armor of God. And then he instructs us what to do. Verse 18. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert. Always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Third strategy for winning spiritual warfare, spiritual battles. Know your enemy, have the right equipment, wear the right equipment, and engage in battle. We need to engage in battle. Here is a short video clip of how to not do that.
Morning.
Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Six shot, the same shot of John Cleese running six times. And the guards they're equipped, right? They're ready. They're standing at their posts. They just don't do anything. They don't engage in battle. And it kind of faded out on you there, but I really like it. He comes up and he runs through the first guard, and the second one just says, hey, as he goes running in. Does that ever happen to you? You know, the enemy runs circles around you. You say, hey, I should have been ready. I should have engaged. Once we've got our armor on, okay, it's time to fight. Time to engage the enemy. How do we do that? Well, here's what Paul says, the passage we just read. Pray at all times and all occasions. Pray in the power of the Spirit. Pray with alertness. Pray with persistence. Prayer is a primary weapon for engaging our enemy. Not the only one, but it's a biggie. That's where Paul goes. After he talks about the armor of God, he gives four different commands to pray. Charles Kuralt used to host a show on CBS called On the Road, and he would go around the country and visit different people in different places. He once visited the chapel of Maria Angelorum in La Crosse, Wisconsin. That's the back to the nuns. Yeah. Every hour of every day, the Franciscan Sisters of Perpetual Adoration. There we go. There they are. Some of them. The Franciscan Sisters of Perpetual Adoration have been praying without interruption for 100 years. Every hour, every day, and night for a century, here's how they do it. Two of the sisters have been on their knees side by side, always praying for the same things. For an end to sickness and hunger, for an end to social injustice, for wisdom in places of power, for their city, for their country, for their friends, for their enemies, for all people, including you and me, always ending, Lord, bring your peace to the world. Sister Mylita first took her place in this chain of prayer back in 1915. And in the 70s, Charles Corralt asked her, so you're just going to go on praying for another 100 years? And Sister Mylita answered, hopefully, yes. Hopefully we can go on for another 100 years, perhaps another 100 years till the end of time. More recently, I don't know if you've seen the news about this, in Wilmore, Kentucky at Asbury University, revival has broken out. And it started how? It started with prayer. There was a chapel service, which students are required to attend at Asbury University. They have chapel that they need to go to. And so you'd think, okay, chapel's over. I'm just going to go to class. I'm going to go to the library. I'm going to go hang out with my friends, whatever they're going to go do. Except a bunch of students decided to not leave. They decided that they needed to pray in response to what they had just heard in that chapel service. And pray they did. And then more people joined them. More students joined them. And then more students from other colleges heard about it, and they came over to join them. Thousands of people praying on this campus of this tiny Christian college in response to the prompting of the Spirit. I gotta say, if you're looking for a religion to make you comfortable, Christianity is not it. This is not. Yes, it has peace. Yes, it has benefits. But following Jesus in the here and now is not about being comfortable. It's not for the lazy or the apathetic. It's for people who will engage in spiritual battle with spiritual equipment against a spiritual enemy. Christianity is for people who will engage in spiritual battle with spiritual equipment against a spiritual enemy. So, I want to invite you to do something with me. Some of you are already doing this, and so I'm joining you in this. Others of you I want to invite to join those of us who are already doing this. And that is to pray for Crow Hill Bible Church every single day. I have made that commitment. I'm serving now as your transition pastor. And so I'm going to pray for Crow Hill Bible Church and have already started doing this. Pray every day. And there's no end to the things you could pray for. You could pray for the whole church. You could pray for the church's witness in this community. You could pray for the staff, and you could pray for the elders. You could pray for the ministry team leaders. You could pray for future leaders. You could pray for the search team, the pastor search team, and pray for your next pastor. You could pray for a particular ministry. You could pray for someone who's sick. You could pray for someone who has problems at work or struggles going on in their family. I could just go on and on and on. And probably so could you once you start praying. But people of God need prayer to stand strong for Jesus. I need prayer. You pray for me. I need prayer. You need prayer. We need prayer. Your church needs prayer. The world needs prayer. Even Paul says right here, pray that I may declare the gospel fearlessly as I should. You ever think of Paul as being afraid of proclaiming the gospel? Does Paul ever need prayer to boldly share the gospel? You'd think this one guy who doesn't need prayer to do this one thing, it's Paul. Church planter extraordinaire, apostle to the Gentiles, someone that God used to change the face of Western civilization through Christianity. And he says to the Ephesians, I get scared sometimes. I'm in prison. Pray for me. Pray for me to share the gospel. Even Paul needed prayer for boldness. So I know that I do. I know that we do. All right, our big idea, Ephesians 6, 10 through 20. Victory comes through fighting spiritual engagements with spiritual equipment against your spiritual enemy. Victory comes through fighting spiritual engagements with spiritual equipment against your spiritual enemy. That's big and clunky, so let's say it together, shall we? Victory comes through fighting spiritual engagements with spiritual equipment against your spiritual enemy. My spiritual enemy, your spiritual enemy, our spiritual enemy. During the time of the 12 Caesars in the Roman Empire, the Roman army would conduct morning inspections. As the inspecting centurion would come in front of each legionnaire there, all decked out in his armor, the soldier would strike with his right fist the armor breastplate that covered the legionnaire's heart, soldier's heart. The armor had to be strongest there in order to protect the heart from a sword thrust or from an arrow strike. The inspecting centurion would listen closely for the ring that he knew the well-kept armor would give off. When he was satisfied the armor was sound, the soldier beneath it was protected, he'd move on to the next man and the next man and the next man. For over four centuries, Roman soldiers held the lines against marauding Goths and Vandals. But by the year 383 AD, social decline that had infected the Republic had had its effects upon the Roman legions. A fourth century Roman general wrote, "When, because of neglect and laziness, parade ground drills were abandoned, the customary armor began to feel heavy since the soldiers rarely, if ever, wore it. Therefore, they first asked the emperor to set aside the breastplates and the chainmail and then the helmets. So our soldiers fought the Goths without any protection for the heart and the head and were often beaten by archers. Although there were many defeats which led to the loss of great cities, no one tried to restore the armor to the infantry. They took their armor off, and where their armor came off, so too came their integrity. It was only the matter of a few years until the legion rotted from within and was unable to hold the frontiers." Victory comes through fighting spiritual engagements with spiritual equipment, the armor of God, against our spiritual enemy. There's good news, though. Christ has already won the war. Let's pray together. Mighty Lord God, you who have no equal, you who are the champion of your people, citizens of your kingdom, Lord, please hear our prayer. We need your help, and we know it. We cannot withstand the spiritual forces that would take us down on our own. Lord, we are grateful that we do not need to stand against them on our own. Please hear our prayers this morning, Lord. Prayers for strength, prayers for stamina, prayers for integrity, prayers to grow in Christian love, Christian truth, Christian righteousness. Lord, you are our champion. We sing to you that as we go out from here, may we walk in you, live in you, and be filled with your Spirit. In the name of your Son. Amen.
To glory, and you are. champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won. I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated, with the one who has conquered it all. Now I can finally see it, teaching me how to receive it. So let all the striving cease. This is my victory, and you are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated, with the one who has conquered it all. Oh yes, you've conquered it all. Oh, we give you praise for the victories, Lord. And when I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority that Jesus has given me. When I open up my mouth, miracles start breaking out. I have the authority Jesus has given me. Oh, and when I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority Jesus has given me. Oh, and when I open up my mouth, miracles start breaking out. I have the authority Jesus has given me. And you are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated by the power of your name. I am seated in the heavenly place, with the one who has conquered it. Oh yes, he has.
The one who has conquered it all is Jesus Christ, fully God, fully man, who came to this earth to live a sinless, perfect human life, willingly gave his life as a sacrifice, a payment for the sins of the world. That means the sins of you and me and us and everyone you know. And then he proved that his Father was satisfied when he was raised to life on the third day on Easter Sunday. He lives still. He reigns above. He is coming back to fully establish his kingdom over the entire created order once and for all. This morning, if you are in need of prayer, we have asked some volunteers from the church leadership, prayer team, to come forward and stand down front, one of the front, two front corners. I'll be around as well and available. If you would like someone to pray with you, pray for you, pray over you, no questions asked. Just make them known what your need is, and they'll offer prayer to God. Also recognize I may be talking to someone who hasn't yet gotten to the place of trusting Jesus is really who he said he was, which means you don't really know what Jesus said about who you are. If you would like to have that conversation or have someone pray on your behalf or just begin to explore that, we invite you to come down front as well. No high pressure. We don't want to sell you anything. We don't want anything from you. We want something for you to know Jesus in his power, in his love, and strength. Go in the peace of Christ. In Jesus' name.